You're listening to the audio production of Organizing for the Rest of Us, 100 Realistic Strategies to Keep Any House Under Control, by Dana K. White, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
Introduction. Here's my promise to you for this book. Everything you read here will be based in reality. Keeping a house under control is not natural for me. My home used to turn into a disaster zone again and again, no matter how many quick tips or nifty tricks I tried. I eventually hit rock bottom and started an anonymous blog where I recorded my thoughts and processes as I worked to figure out what I was doing wrong and what I should be doing instead. I eventually figured it out. Tips help, but no simple trick will magically turn your house into the one that you dream about. That's why we're calling these strategies. Some of them will be quick to implement and will make the overall process of changing your home easier. But others are mindset shifts and changes to the way you do day-to-day tasks that will ultimately make a bigger difference than storing your toothbrush in a different container. As someone who audibly groaned at promises of quick fixes for my lifetime of messiness, I'm excited to share what I've learned in the bite-sized, easy-to-grasp and implement format of this book. There's a lot of value in that. But if you need more words, more answers to all your what-ifs and but-what-abouts, I've got those too. They're in my other books, Decluttering at the Speed of Life and How to Manage Your Home Without Losing Your Mind. Feel free to continue your organizing and decluttering journey with those helpful resources. Part 1. Mindset Shifts. Strategy 1. Understand the layers of a clean house. Have you ever stared in awe at a friend's clean home and wondered, "What in the world do they do that I don't do?" Or have you ever felt like your head might explode when that friend claims she never cleans? Let me explain what people like them know that people like me don't. There are three layers of a clean house, and cleaning is the last layer. If the first two layers are peeled back, cleaning won't be as daunting. The first layer that has to be removed to get to a clean house is clutter. It simply isn't possible to clean a surface, space, or room that is piled with stuff. Decluttering has to happen for a house to look clean, be cleaned, and stay clean. Quick cleaning tips don't make much of an impact in a house that's overloaded with stuff. The second layer of a clean house is daily stuff. Certain tasks need to be done every single day, or at least almost every day. I will teach you the four daily tasks to start with. Doing a week's worth of dishes isn't cleaning your house. It's catching up on daily stuff. Picking up toys or shoes or math worksheets from the living room floor isn't cleaning, it's picking up. Not doing the absolute basics every day means that when you clean, you spend hours excavating the kitchen. By the time you're done, all the cleaning energy you started with is gone. The third layer is the actual cleaning. Dusting, vacuuming, mopping, wiping, and scrubbing. When my house was full of clutter, I was forever behind on daily tasks. Cleaning my house was a huge and daunting project that I continually put off. Once I peeled back the first two layers of a clean house, I understood those people with perfectly fine houses who said they never cleaned. They were talking about actual cleaning. That's the beauty of understanding the layers of a clean house. If layers 1 and 2 are under control, layer 3 doesn't feel so urgent. So, yes, this book will contain tips and tricks, but I want you to know that I understand those of you who balk at 10 easy ways to keep your house perfect lists. I understand because there was a time when I didn't understand, and that's the perspective from which I write this book. Strategy 2. Understand what clutter is and find your clutter threshold. I define clutter as anything that continually gets out of control in my own home. Defining clutter this way has improved my home because this definition means clutter is no longer an ambiguous idea. I no longer need to evaluate each item in my home for its potential to be used in the future or how it makes me feel. Instead, I know that if a space in my home continually gets out of control, there's too much stuff in that space. There is clutter, and I need to declutter that space. If it keeps getting out of control, there's still clutter. I need to keep decluttering until I'm able to keep it under control. Clutter is anything that gets out of control in your home. Clutter is personal. Your clutter threshold is why it's personal. You have a clutter threshold, and if your home is usually out of control, you're living above it. Your clutter threshold is the amount of stuff that you personally can easily keep under control in your own home. If your house is constantly falling back into disaster status, you have too much stuff. The good news is that once you reach your clutter threshold, you'll like your home more. The bad news is that you can only find your clutter threshold by decluttering. There's no way to predict what your threshold will be. Solve the problem of your home making you crazy by decluttering. Does it still make you crazy? You need to declutter more. Is it still driving you bananas? Keep decluttering. One day, you'll look around your home and realize, wow, my house is staying under control and I no longer feel like I'm hanging off the edge of a cliff by my fingernails. You've reached your clutter threshold. Congratulations! Now, all you have to do is keep decluttering. If something comes into your home, something else has to leave to make room. That's how you maintain a home that you can keep maintaining. Strategy 3. Embrace less and better. After what felt like millions of failed attempts to get my act together in my own house, but was probably only hundreds of thousands, I finally accepted that the way I'd been attempting to change was never going to work. Less and better are more effective goals to work toward than finished or done. I love to be done as much as or more than anyone. Some of the strategies I'll share later will be all about the power of finishing. But when it came to decluttering my ridiculously cluttered home, the goal of finishing decluttering backfired. First of all, it isn't actually possible. Homes that stay clutter-free have people in them who never stop decluttering. Decluttering success is having less stuff in your house than you did before. This means that even if a space is not finished, perfectly free of clutter, as long as I have removed anything that should not be there, I have successfully decluttered. I'm not done, but there is less. The space is better than it was when I started. Better is good. It's progress. Even if I am sure I won't be able to finish, there is value in making a space better. Embracing less and better as valuable goals allows me to start. I am willing to do something, even if I don't have the confidence or time to do the job perfectly. Focusing on having less and making my home better is what finally brought about real change in my home. This mindset shift helped me get started and helps me keep going. Doing something makes my home better, so much better than it ever was, simply because there is less. Strategy 4. Just declutter. This book is called Organizing for the Rest of Us, but I'm telling you to just declutter. Decluttering is the secret truly organized people know, even though they don't know it's a secret. Decluttering is the missing piece of the puzzle for those of us who have spent our lives trying to get organized but couldn't. When I started what I call my deslobification process, I thought I was giving up when I decided organizing was hopeless for me and I was just going to declutter. Instead, that small but significant change in my thoughts and tactics ultimately changed everything. When I focused exclusively on getting stuff out of my house instead of looking for creative ways to keep my stuff, my home started to look more organized, feel more organized, and function more organized. I achieved what I'd wanted all along. I had a house that stayed under control. I knew what I had and could find what I needed when I needed it, and I did this by just decluttering. Organizing and decluttering are two different things. Organizing is problem solving, and while I'll share some ways to do that, problem solving can be overwhelming. Organizing isn't possible when there's more stuff than could ever fit in my home. Give yourself permission, or take my permission, to just declutter. It will give you permission to get started. Remove the stuff that shouldn't be in your home. That alone will solve the majority of your frustrations. Don't worry, I'll give you the steps you need to actually do it. Strategy 5. Stop treating your house like a project. I love projects, and I feel competent tackling them. I love planning, executing, and evaluating projects. Because projects are my thing, I treated my house like a project, but that didn't work. Your house isn't a project, and treating your home like one does more harm than good. There's no beginning, middle, or end. There's definitely no end. The project mindset lends itself to putting off starting until there's time to really do things right. While you wait for that ideal time, the house gets worse, which means cleaning it up will require even more effort, so you put off starting even longer. It becomes a vicious cycle. If a top-to-bottom clean ever does happen, celebrating the big finish of being done, especially when you're exhausted from working like a maniac, means you want to rest and enjoy your accomplishment. But dishes keep getting dirty. Trash cans keep filling. Dust falls and toilets get used. I felt like I was done after tackling my house like a project, and that was the reason I constantly felt bewildered. I was looking for a complicated answer to what felt like an incredibly complicated problem, so I couldn't see that the answer was simple. The key to getting your home under control is the little stuff. The big secret is not top-to-bottom cleaning every weekend. It's doing the dishes on Monday, and then doing the dishes again on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and even on Saturday and Sunday. Even if we went out to eat and the only dishes were 6 cereal bowls, 9 spoons, 2 coffee cups, and a popcorn bowl. The unexciting and non-dramatic stuff keeps the house from turning into a project that is procrastination worthy. Who knew? Strategy 6. Follow the visibility rule to gain decluttering momentum. When you get the itch to declutter, whether there's a little too much or a lot too much, figuring out where to start can be overwhelming. I learned the hard way that decluttering momentum is best achieved by following the visibility rule. Tackling a rarely used drawer in the garage feels so right, but it's wrong. The work you do in that rarely seen or used space won't inspire you to keep going because you will almost never see or experience the impact of your efforts. Start decluttering in the most visible area of your home. Not the most cluttered area, the most visible area. I recommend starting at your front door or whichever door guests enter. There's nothing more discouraging in your decluttering journey than working all day but still wanting to hide when the neighbor knocks on your door. The biggest benefit of following the visibility rule, though, is that if you work on a visible space, you will see the results of your decluttering effort. While your brain might not have registered the mess, it will register the cleared space. Every time you walk by this cleared space, you'll feel a little giddy and a lot prouder of yourself for how much better it looks. Those good feelings will inspire you to declutter more sooner. Your decluttering energy will increase. Keep going with the next visible space, and you'll gain decluttering momentum. Strategy 7. Decide procrastinate-clutter is worth your time. Procrastinate-clutter is a thing, a very real thing. Procrastinate-clutter makes many a struggling declutterer moan, "I feel like I'm always decluttering, but my house never looks better." Procrastinate-clutter is the stuff that doesn't seem like legitimate clutter, so it's easy to put off dealing with it when you're in the midst of a real decluttering project. I made up the word, so I get to define it. You'll have to deal with procrastinate-clutter eventually, so you know you'll do it eventually. This moment of, "I'm finally decluttering right now," doesn't seem like the right time to deal with that kind of stuff since it isn't real clutter. Examples of procrastinate clutter include piles of clean but folded laundry on the recliner, clean dishes sitting in the dish drainer, or the stack of papers waiting to be filed in the cabinet it's sitting atop. Dealing with procrastinator feels like stealing time and energy from real decluttering. I had to accept the fact that if I leave piles of procrastinator in a room, whatever work I do in there isn't going to have as obvious an impact. The room will still look messy. Give yourself permission to deal with procrastinator.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.